Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
We're back for another Fireside Chat after a long and wet summer here in Calgary. And we are here in late September, which means we're staring down the barrel of another hockey season. As always, I'm Dan Stevenson alongside my co-host Matt DeBorg. How you doing, Matt?
Good. It's been a long summer. I'm looking forward to watching some Flames hockey coming up soon.
It's September 20th as we record this, and I'm kind of sad because out in my backyard, all my trees have turned color already, and it's not even October.
Oh, I know. This whole summer has been a bit weird, so hopefully the winter is a little bit more normal and not as much moisture coming down.
If we had a winter like last year, I'd take it. Last year was a nice mild winter.
Yeah.
Well, let's get to hockey news. We've got a lot to talk about. The Flames have yet to play an exhibition game officially, but the Penticton tournament is in the books, and we'll get to that. But I don't know about everyone else. It's been a long summer, and the Flames have had a lot of roster moves. So let's get to looking at some of those moves. I think where we'll start, because there's a lot of names there, is the guys who are leaving us. And I'll take a big, deep breath before this one, because there's a lot of names. The Flames bought out the Mason Raymond contract this summer, paid what they had to pay to get rid of him, and he's moved on to Anaheim. I don't know what you think, Matt. No love lost there.
No, he underperformed here, and the Flames simply have too many players to fill his spot.
Some people said this summer that, oh, well, Raymond might do better under a new coach, but to me, he was given more chances than he should have been last year, and he didn't perform in any of them, so I don't see any reason to think a new coach would change that.
Exactly.
He was waived, what, twice or three times last year?
I think three.
So he had plenty of chances. The other big name that the Flames lose, probably bigger than Mason Raymond, the only real, I guess, potential long-term roster guy was Joel Colborne, who left the Flames a UFA and then signed with the Avalanche. I think there's a good pickup for the Avs. I think he'll be missed here, but I don't think he's going to be missed as much as some fans think. I don't think that he was as imperative going forward to this team as we might think that he was.
And if you look in our organization, we have a player that is more or less the same generic type of guy as Colborne in Mark Jankowski. And when Jankowski first went to the NCAA, he started as a right winger. And Colborne is also a center and a right winger. So there is a possibility if Jankowski makes the team out of training camp that he could basically fill his spot.
Yeah, Colborne was up and down here. He was a fan favorite. And sometimes we have to remember that, you know, just because we like a guy like Brian McGrattan or Colborne doesn't necessarily mean that they need to be a long-term Flame. And I think money-wise, I think that Colorado gave him a good deal and he was smart to take it.
Yeah.
And like you said, it's an easy role to fill. Let's be honest, this guy's probably a third-line player. I mean, he's not a, you know, a top six forward on a team that's hopefully going to make the playoffs.
Precisely, and you can't spend too much on players like a guy like Colborne because those become your anchor contracts that prevent you from re-signing somebody that's more important down the
road.
And
I think in the salary cap era we're in, you're going to see a lot more turnover in the bottom six forward positions and probably the bottom two or three defense positions. Like, I think every 2 years, you're going to be seeing new guys filling all those roles, so you can't get too attached to those bottom six players. Other names that people probably know, Chad Billings went to Vancouver Canucks organization. Turner Elson got signed by the Colorado Avalanche organization. Josh Juris, another player that played at the NHL level, went to the Rangers. You and I talked about Juris last year, and again, I think we both thought that he was replaceable. He really didn't have a good year last year. This guy had 1 year. He was sort of a flash in the pan, and I think Juris will be a journeyman who's just going to go from team to team for whoever needs a cheap, you know, bottom six veteran. What do you think?
Well, if his hand is better, his hand and wrist, because I do believe that's the injury he suffered, if that is better, then I think he may have a season that's closer to his first NHL season. If not, then he'll just be your typical 13th forward for a number of years on a whole bunch of different teams and bounce around between the A and the NHL.
And the last player that got an NHL contract who was a Flame last year is Derek Grant. And Mixed feelings on this one for me. I think Grant was a good call-up when we brought him up. I don't think he necessarily got the chances he needed here. But you know what? Again, a guy that can be replaced either through the organization or through a UFA signing.
Yeah, exactly. The team has plenty of good forwards that are on the verge of being NHL ready. And if you're looking at, say, like playing Mark Jankowski at the NHL level versus Derek Grant, you'd go with the kid that might develop into something more. So realistically, the Flames don't need a guy like Grant, where last year they did.
And we'll talk more about this guy later, but I mean, even, you know, player they brought in over the summer, Lyndon Vay, could easily be that replacement for Grant.
Exactly.
Couple Flames that did not get a job in the NHL but do have a job. Joni Ordio, our former goaltender, has gone to Sweden. We all expected they would cut ties with him, and they did. And Nicklas Backstrom, who we got at the trade deadline, has gone off to Finland. Bryce Van Brabrandt, who is a AHL player, played a couple games here in his first year after we signed him out of college. But really, I mean, a guy whose career is probably always going to be AHL or somewhere around there, signed an ECHL deal. And we still have a bunch of guys who were Flames last year that are unsigned. We have Kevin Poulin, who's unsigned, Drew Shore, who's unsigned, Kenny Agostino, Bill Arnold, and Kerry Ramo, who are unsigned. So all our goaltenders have been moved. And to me, when I look at this list, there's nobody here I'm really upset that left. I think Colborn, if we could have got him in a reasonable price, we could keep around. But I agree with you. He's, you know, a guy that we could afford to lose. What about you, Matt?
There's nobody that's going to hinder the Flames moving forward.
Or even Stockton, I don't think.
No.
Poulin was always brought in as a backup. Drew Shore, I don't know. He's been given chances, and he's just never risen to the occasion. I hate seeing Agostino leaving because that was part of that Jerome McGinley deal, and you want some better out of him. Bill Arnold, I really think this was part of that, you know what, we'll sign you to get Gaudreau to sign with us. They were good friends, but Arnold has never, I don't think, really stood out as his own player. I think he kind of got lost in the shuffle without Johnny Hockey with him. And Kerry Ramo is still hurt. I think he could get an NHL job eventually this year.
Yeah, as soon as like somebody, you know, because there's 30 teams, somebody's going to have goaltender issue problem with injuries, or somebody just plays terribly. So I'm assuming that eventually Ramo will sign a one-year deal with whichever team that is that runs into those problems.
And if not, from what I understand, Vegas is allowed to start making hockey moves January 1. Do you think if he's still available, they might throw a deal on him?
I doubt it, just due to the fact that with the expansion draft, the best players that will likely be available to them are the goaltenders.
Because they're going to have to fill out an AHL roster, too.
True, but if it's me, like, I'd rather go with somebody that a team, like, say, like, Winnipeg, they have a handful of good goalie prospects, or say Vancouver, they have a few good goalies. They're gonna have to expose some of them. So
yeah, I know what you're saying. I just also look at previous, what was it, like the Blue Jackets drafted like six goalies, so you can never have too many goalies, and they can be used in trades too. You know, take a good Vancouver goalie, trade them somebody else, you never know. But I think that could be a possibility for Ramo.
Yeah.
So those are the guys that we've lost, but replacing them, we have some new Flames. We have some that you and I talked about during our rookie camp episode. Troy Brower came into the Flames, and we have a completely new net mining team of Brian Elliott and Chad Johnson. We've discussed those guys in depth. Anything else about those guys you want to say that hasn't already been covered?
No, just looking forward to seeing them on the ice and see how they gel with whomever they're paired with, or like in Brower's case, and see how Elliott and Johnson adapt to the Flames defense.
Well, and if nothing else, we've automatically, like, even if we just brought in those three players, we've automatically upgraded this team, if nothing else, and we have solid net minding.
I agree. And like, if you want to look at it this way, if you discount the disastrous October last season when all three of the goaltenders were playing terribly, and replace it with just an adequate point percentage, the Flames would have been in the hunt for a playoff spot all the way through the season. So just the fact that we've got two of the top save percentage guys from last season, that even if they're just an average NHL goaltender at this season, that will be a huge improvement for the team and could very well make the difference between a top six pick in the draft and being in a playoff spot.
I also think that bringing in an experienced backup like Johnson sort of sets John Gillies' place in the organization, that he's going to be, now he's healthy, expect to be the HL starter. I think that we've sort of set, I mean, he could always win the job, but I think on paper now, you have a top two and you have Gillies in the AHL.
And realistically, after missing a full season last year, you don't want to rush Gillies into the season and rely on him, because you can screw up a goaltender's development. Like, he's doing a good job. Let him get 40 or 50 games in the AHL, and if need be, you can bring him up at that point.
I think maybe last year there was more of a rush because you had him and Ordeo. You know, and I think now that he's really the only, I mean, him and McDonald, but he's really kind of the only next goaltending prospect for the Flames who's almost ready, you can give him the time he needs. And you feel comfortable with Johnson as a backup, where it's like, okay, I'd rather have Johnson sit on the bench than Gillies sit on the bench.
Yeah, and realistically, like, all of McDonald, Parsons, and Schneider, they're at least 3 years away from being in the conversation to be an NHL goaltender. So where Gillies, he could conceivably make his NHL debut this season if they run into an injury.
And I mean, Chad Johnson's only on a 1 year deal, so I think
they both are. So
yeah, I mean, but we're not probably looking for a new starter next year. So I think that you know, if Gillies comes in and he's good, I think you say, okay, they're both, like you said, they're both on 1 years, but you easily let Johnson go and bring Gillies in.
Yeah.
I think we'll see Elliott be here for a couple of years.
It depends on how they play this season. I think they're both on auditions, and again, next year you're going to have other goaltenders that are available, either via trade with Las Vegas after they draft whomever, because you're going to assume they're going to pick five or six goalies, like you said, with previous expansion drafts. So there's an option there.
Marc-Andre Fleury.
Yeah, or you could sign Fleury or Ben Bishop or any number of UFA goalies, because I think there's, I think, five or six good ones this year. So there's options if Elliott and Johnson don't perform up to ideal expectations.
So those are the three guys we'll probably see the most of, as in terms of guys coming in, as Brouwer, Elliott, and Johnson. But the Flames did make some other signings as well. They made one trade. They made a trade with Ottawa, trading Pat Seeloff to the Senators and getting back forward Alex Chiasson. Chiasson has played with our coach Glenn Gulletson in Dallas, so there's some familiarity there. I think Chiasson really becomes your sort of Colborne bottom six fill-in guy. He's a right shot. He's a right winger. He's making $800,000. I don't think you can go wrong here, and I think that Seeloff, you and I have talked about this for years. I like Seeloff. I think ever since his injury, though, he got off track. And I think this is just two guys that both need a fresh start.
And that's good for Seeloff to get an opportunity. Like, he's been passed by so many players in the Flames organization that there just isn't enough room. And
well, at one point, he and Wotherspoon were sort of the only Flames defensemen.
Yeah, but now, like, the Flames have a legitimate top four, and then you've got guys like Fox, Shillington, Anderson, Hickey, Kulak, Culkin, Wotherspoon. Like, there's just not enough room. So the Flames are dealing from an area of depth to address a weakness.
So Alex Chiasson is on a one-year deal worth $800,000, and he'll be wearing number 39 this coming season. So I don't think this is a guy, again, that probably sticks around long-term. I mean, you know, $800,000 probably turns into $1 million next year, and I think we're going to probably move him on after a year unless he plays really well. But I think for a one-year guy, he's a good transitional player.
if he plays like Dallas's version of Chiasson, then he'll become a useful bottom six forward. If he plays like Ottawa's version, he'll be a Flame for 1 year, and he might even be waived at some point.
And another player that has a one-year deal who comes to us most familiar to Flames fans from the Vancouver Canucks organization, who's on a $700,000 deal, and it's a two-way contract, is Lyndon Vey. Lyndon Vey is 25. He's 6 foot, 200 pounds. Vey, he can play. He's listed as a right winger. He can play a couple positions, but again, right wing depth with the team needs. I think Vey honestly becomes the next Derek Grant. I think he starts the year in the AHL, and he's kind of your first veteran call up.
Could very well be.
Chiasson will start in the NHL, and Vey will start in the AHL.
This is one of those things that'll be largely determined by how each of the players and several of the prospects perform in training camp. If some of them play poorly, the prospects that, you know, like say like a Matthew Tkachuk, I think some people are hoping and expecting him to take a spot, but if he disappoints in the preseason, then that opens up an opportunity for a guy like Vey to take a spot. So it just depends. But I agree with you. Likely, he'll be the AHL veteran.
And one player that we talked about in previous shows that was brought in is the Czech Republic free agent, Daniel Priebel, who's 23 years old. He's a forward, and I don't know. I always have mixed feelings on these. I mean, we've seen some of them, like Cervenka, that stunk when we brought these guys in. We've seen some of them, like Nakladal, who are good. So the jury's kind of out about Priebel right now. I think we really have to wait and see. But again, a guy I don't think, of course anything can happen, but a guy I don't think is going to make the Flames roster.
Again, have to just compare like with like during the preseason and see how it goes.
But I mean, if you're building your roster today, Matt, do you have Priebel on it?
Probably not.
Do you have Vey on it?
Probably not.
So, you know, I mean, anything can happen as we know, right? But when we're building rosters today, I don't have either of those guys on there, I think.
Yeah, like if you're looking at like a 13th forward, Vey might make sense. But Priebel, I'd have playing first line minutes in the A.
I honestly think your 13th forward, well, we'll talk about it, but I think Bolig fits into that role.
Although he might, because his contract is a little bit higher, I think the Flames may opt to just waive him and send him down to save some money in order to afford Gaudreau. But that's for...
But yeah, if we're looking at four lines of forwards, I don't have either of those guys slot into my four lines of forwards.
No.
And then two former NHL players who are here on a PTO. Last time we saw a big-name PTO was Rafael Diaz, who got a contract off that. But we have Chris Higgins, which is actually kind of interesting, a former Calgary Flame, and Nick Grossman, who are both here on part-time agreements. And I don't know about you, I can actually see Higgins potentially making the team again.
I could see it. And it, again, it depends on the performance of some of the bottom line forwards. Like, if guys like Matt Stajan and Lance Boma really disappoint, then I could see him taking a spot from either of those players.
Higgins is 33. He made $2.5 million last year. He's a left winger, shoots left. I mean, he's been a Flame. He was only here for 12 games. He was part of the...
Code Leak. Well, he was part of
the Code Leak deal, one of the most controversial deals. So he was traded to Calgary with Code Leak for Jokinen and Prost. And you know what? As a guy who just got bought out, he's got a lot of cash in his pocket. So I can almost see it like, remember when Bertuzzi played here after getting bought out? I can see him coming for not a lot of money because he just got his payday. And he could be a good veteran, maybe that 13th forward role.
And same with Nick Grossman. He could end up being a quality number 7 guy if a guy like Wotherspoon or Kulak can't actually cement themselves into that spot during the training camp.
But even last year, the Flames had a couple veteran NHL players who were just playing as AHL guys. Like Aaron Johnston was one of them, and somebody else was down there. So I could even see Grossman coming in almost expected to start the year at the A. You know, pair him up with somebody like Shillington down there as a veteran presence. and see if he can work his way back up. But I, looking at our veteran or at our defense depth, I would not put Grossman in as a top seven. But he is, just for those that don't know, he's 31 years old. He's played primarily in Philadelphia's organization. That's where most people know him, but he's played for Dallas as well. He played last year, part of the year, with the Coyotes. I've always liked Grossman. I thought he's good. I think sometimes he's overused in some organizations. I think he would be a good 6-7 guy, but he's not. I don't think you want to put him much higher than that.
Yeah. I think he's basically like a Ladislav Smead type guy. A decent 6-7.
I think Grossman's almost a year too early on this deal. I think that, you know, without an overpaid Weidman in the lineup, he might get a spot. But I think that, you know, this year we've got some issues on defense, and it might just cause him not to get a contract.
I agree.
Two players that are returning who were free agents that we've re-signed. The biggest name was Sean Monahan. He signed a big deal to stay in Calgary for a while. And the other one was Tyler Wotherspoon, who, I don't know, this guy, we, not that we want to get rid of him, but he's always coming back. Even when he has disappointing seasons, I think he's going to be a mainstay here for a while. But I think this is the final contract. I think Wotherspoon either becomes an NHL regular or he's done.
Yeah, well, I think that we're going to see that with a handful of the Flames' defensive prospects. Between him, Brett Kulak, Ryan Culkin, and Kenny Morrison, they're all of their contracts end this season. So if they don't step up and show that they're like NHL caliber players, then I think the Flames will just move on from all of them and allow guys like Shillington and Anderson, who are close to being ready for the NHL, to take their spots instead.
Yeah, I just don't know if we have the HL depth to let them all go. I think you'd see a guy like Morrison kept on a two-way or even just sign an AHL deal, just because I don't think they're ready to give up on him quite yet.
Yeah. And again, it depends on how each of them plays. So we'll see.
And the Flames still have two outstanding contracts. We didn't talk about Jakub Niklaudl. Technically, he's an unrestricted free agent, so he's out as well. You know, as much as we might still think of him as a Flame, legally he's not. But the two outstanding deals that we still have are Johnny Gaudreau and Freddie Hamilton. And, I mean, of those two, it's probably pretty sure that if we want Hamilton back, he's back. But the Gaudreau contract's the interesting one. Gaudreau's actually in a really weird state of free agency. He's an RFA by name, but he has no rights. This was a situation that Torrey Krug and Jaden Schwartz were in a couple years ago. The only thing he can really do at this point is refuse to play. He can't be signed. He can't be offer sheeted. So really, I mean, he has none of the rights that a regular RFA would have. But this has taken a while to get done, Matt. Are you getting worried that we may not have the services of Johnny Gaudreau come the start of the season?
Not at all. I think it's just a matter of figuring out the exact details of the contract. He wants to be here for a long time. The Flames want him to be here for a long time. Realistically, I'm sure the Flames are probably offering in the 7-ish range, and he's wanting closer to the 8-ish range. And overall, like on an 8-year deal, the difference is probably about $4 or $5 million that they're apart, which is a lot of money, but on the other hand, it's not. I think the main thing that's causing it to stall is that the Flames are wanting to see if they can possibly free up some cash because of their current salary cap status.
You're thinking about moving a big contract.
Yeah, and saving a few bucks that way, and that way you have a little bit more flexibility, so that way you can offer Gaudreau slightly more without hampering your ability to recall players if you run into injury troubles.
We'll talk cap in a couple minutes. The thing that I haven't seen a lot of people talk about, if you remember our first contract to Gaudreau when he was at Boston College, that one took a while to get done too. Like, if I remember, that pretty much came down to the wire where we had to sign him or we'd lose his rights, and it was like the
night
before.
No, we had a year. We had a year more, yeah.
Okay. Then maybe it was the night before. It was some deadline. Maybe it was like the night before the last game of the season or something.
It was.
Because I remember being at the game, and they showed a clip of Craig Conroy signing him, and everybody cheered. And as we know, he came the next day and he played the game and he burned the first year of his contract. And I mean, we can talk about it now or later in the season, but I still think that's a terrible thing to do, is play a game and burn a year. We didn't need him in the lineup at the time. I know he wants to as a player, but as a team, it's like, you know what? We've just lost a year of his service.
True, but he might not have signed otherwise, so...
Yeah, I don't know. I don't think you can put in the contract that you're going to play a guy.
Yeah, well, it's one of those things that if they didn't play him, then that would have created some harsh feelings between himself and the team, and then he probably would have demanded a trade or whatever.
Yeah, so. I don't know. I just think if you're joining a new team and they're paying you as much as you are, you got to be a bit of a team player and say, you know what, I've signed this deal. You know, you're paying me, I think you got a $90,000 signing bonus. So, you know what, I understand. I've got a huge money contract. I've got to wait till next season to play. Like, you know, they were doing him a favor by giving him an NHL deal, and he's making a huge amount of money, and I think there's
conversely, he could have waited out the final year of his NCAA career and then just gone and signed with, say, Philadelphia.
For sure, but I think it sets a precedent league-wide, and I think it's something that has to be addressed at some point, and I wouldn't be surprised if it's part of the new CBA. Because I can't imagine management's too happy when that happens either.
Yeah, we'll see. Yeah, I don't complain. I'm not complaining about how that was handled.
That one specifically, but I think we might see it again with other prospects in the future where it could become an issue.
Yeah, and again, it's not that big of a deal in my mind.
It's more of a deal in hindsight. At the time, it didn't seem like a big deal, but I think in hindsight, looking at now getting a huge contract done, you know, now it becomes that, hey, if we had an extra year on that deal, it would be really nice.
Yeah. But then again, like, if, say he goes out and puts up 80 points this season, like, say he's on the final year of his entry level this year, then instead of asking for, say, $7.5 million a year for 8 years, he might be asking for $9 million a year for 8 years. So,
yeah, I don't know.
It's one of those things that...
I don't think the money's going to change all that much either way in terms of what the actual per year cap hit would be.
Yeah, it might. It depends on how good of a year he has. And based off of how he's played in the World Cup, I think he's going to be having a good one.
I was also not surprised that Monahan got signed first. I know a lot of people were, but I think the Gaudreau's camp wanted a benchmark. I think that by signing Monahan, now they have a number to say ours has to be higher.
Yeah.
So I was not surprised that Monahan got done first, but I'm a little bit surprised that Gaudreau's lasted this long. I hope he's not a holdout. I don't think he's going to be a holdout. I think as young as he is, being a holdout this young is going to reflect badly on his career.
Yeah.
But
I don't see it. We still have almost a full month till the puck drop for the start of the season. I have pretty much zero concern about him not being in the lineup for the first game up in Edmonton.
No, but I think, you know, playing devil's advocate, if he does hold out or refuse to sign here, we'll get a king's ransom for him if we have to move
sure.
the contract. Like,
for sure.
You know, if you think that we got, you know, you can argue if we got a good deal on, like, the Nieuwendyk contract when that happened, but if we have to move Gaudreau, we'll get a king's ransom for him. So I think either way we win. I'd love to see him in a Flames jersey. I just bought a new Gaudreau jersey. But if we have to move him, we're still going to win with that deal.
Oh, definitely. Like, you can imagine, like, if, say, Chicago wanted to trade Patrick Kane back when they, just after his first contract, what they would have got for him. Well, it's pretty much the same exact thing that what we'd get for Gaudreau. So the odds of him getting dealt or any of this actually being a problem, though, I think is...
No, for sure. And I totally agree with you. I just want to kind of, you know, set the stage and play the devil's advocate that if worst comes to worst and we have to deal Gaudreau, I think the Flames are still going to end up on top. Yeah, we're going to lose a great player, but the assets we'll get back will still allow this team to stay competitive.
Well... And we'll be in the Nolan Patrick sweepstakes, so there's that, too.
That's true. Well, then we'd have one guy on our first line, Monahan.
Yeah.
And it'd be like Jerome again. We got to find him two guys to play with.
Yeah.
That wraps up our new, old, returning faces for the Flames. So very different look this year. This was really the year the Flames purged a lot of, I guess, old management guys. You know, guys like Elson, guys like Van Braberen, guys like Shore, Arnold. These are guys that have been around for a while. And I think, to me, this sort of sends the message that, you know what, if you're not progressing, you're out.
Yeah. And if you look at guys like Agostino and Arnold, like, they could play as like a 13th, 14th forward. Sort of like David Vandergulik in his role with the Avalanche after he left Calgary. But the Flames have a lot of good prospects that are coming up into the AHL soon. There's not enough room, simply, to have all of those guys and hope that one of them figures it out. And
both have been given a fair shot.
Oh, for sure.
They've been around here for a while. They've been given a fair shot. I'm also... Oh, it turns out that Agostino got signed by the Blues organization.
There you go.
So I would not be surprised if we saw Bill Arnold at some point in Stockton this year.
He might.
I think he's a good... I think he'll end up being one of these guys that could be a good AHL hand.
Wherever he ends up, I think he'll be a good AHL hand, whether it's with us or some other organization.
Maybe that's the holdup on the Gaudreau deals. They got to bring Billy back.
Yeah, possibly.
So we were talking a little bit about salary cap earlier, and one of the biggest, I think you're right, the biggest hurdles to the Gaudreau deal. According to the numbers, I mean, you're seeing it roughly changing based on whose numbers you look at, but the Flames are having a projected $7.964 million cap space this year. So I think in order to do anything right now without moving a contract, you can't sign Gaudreau for more than seven.
Maybe 7.25 at the upper limit, but yeah. And that's where things kind of get into a dicey situation, because realistically you're going to need to have a 13th forward, a 14th forward. And
right now we have a 21-man roster and 40 of our 50 total contracts. So there's still a few positions to be signed if we want to be competitive. I mean, it's easy to patch those holes and say, okay, we got a roster, let's go. But it depends how competitive you want to be this year.
True. And I think the Flames, especially with the acquisition of the two goaltenders that they did, that they're wanting to be a competitive team. So it makes things a little bit more difficult. And in the past, we've heard some minor rumblings of like a potential Jimmy Hayes for Dennis Wideman type trade with Boston. That would save the Flames about $2 million, $2.5 million in for this season, although Hayes does have an extra year on his deal. Something along those lines would make some sense, and it would free up a spot for the Flames to go out and sign a player on a one-year deal.
And I guess if nothing else, is a good year to have to re-sign Gaudreau, because we can literally say we have no more money to give you.
Yeah.
You know, like next year we've got a lot of contracts coming off the books. If we take a look, we have Bolig at $1.25 million. We got Wideman at $5.25 million. Smead at 3.5, England at 2.9, and both of our goalies at 2.5 and 1.7. So we got a lot of money coming off the books. So, yeah, it's just a matter of, I think, you don't need to worry long term. It's just a matter of getting some breathing room for this season.
Yeah. So, on the whole, I think that the Flames will still probably make a move or two in the preseason to clear up some space. Whether that's sending a guy like a Bolig down to the AHL just to clear up a couple hundred grand. You know, there's plenty of different options, though.
And I think that, like, the Freddie Hamilton deal will come as soon as the Gaudreau deal's over. I think they don't want to spend any more money till Gaudreau's signed. But I think once he's signed, whatever's left goes to Hamilton.
Yeah, and realistically, Hamilton's not going to be a particularly complicated deal.
I have a feeling the deal's done. It's just not been faxed into league yet. You know, yeah. They probably know roughly what they want to pay him.
Yeah, like it's not like he has a lot of things
demands
to stand on. Like,
no.
It's not like he scored 20 goals last year and like it's complicated because of that. He played a handful of games at the NHL level and was okay. So
his deal should almost be made like 10% of whatever his brother's making.
Yeah.
But the one interesting wrinkle in our salary cap situation for this year, and here's a name I never thought we'd talk about on the show, all goes back to Shane O'Brien. Back when the Flames bought Shane O'Brien out of his contract in June of 2014, everyone expected that it was a compliance buyout, which at the time they were giving teams two compliance buyouts a year, which had no cap hit implications. So as of 2012, teams were permitted two compliance buyouts, which allowed a team to buy them out with no penalty. Still to pay the guy out. You had to give him money to go away, but it didn't count against your cap. The weird thing, though, is it's now been confirmed by CapFriendly.com that the buyout was not a compliance buyout and instead a standard buyout, which is resulting in last year a $500,000 hit and this year a $700,000 hit against the cap. And that essentially, I mean, $700,000 with where we're at, that's a big hit. So 2014-2015, it was a $500,000 hit. 2015-2016, it was a $700,000 hit, which puts them into an overage this year because of that and all the bonuses they paid out. So we're going to have some cap implications this year. But what I'm trying to figure out is if you have two compliance buyouts, why do you not use one on O'Brien?
I know. Like, that.
How did this happen?
Yeah, that's just sloppy, period.
And I don't know. Like, I don't think the league wants to screw any team. How do you fax this in and whoever looks at the league going, you didn't check the compliance box. Did you mean to? You know, I don't think they're like, oh, we got Calgary. You know, like, if I was the guy at the league office doing the paperwork, I'd probably call the Flames, like, hey, the compliance box isn't checked on this form or whatever it is. You know, did you forget that? Like, I don't know how this goes through and how we've ended up paying over $1 million for an error that's now, you know, last year we had tons of room. The year before we had tons of cap room, so it probably didn't matter. But this year it's going to cause us issues because of overage penalties. Like, how did this happen?
Just sloppiness, that's all. And it happens. Like, every team has something occasionally that crops up that was an error, and that was an error. There's no sugarcoating it. It was a mistake. And now the Flames are paying for it due to cap overage penalties from last season.
I'd say we never would have known about it if it wasn't for the overage stuff. Like, it wouldn't have mattered.
Yeah. So it's just frustrating, but not much you can do.
So for those that don't know, players that have a bonus in their contract, those bonuses do count against the salary cap. So often you don't know about those bonuses till the end of the year, and then there's overage penalties. So we essentially went over the salary cap by the end of the year because we had bonuses to pay out. So that's going to be seen as a hit against us this year in terms of a penalty for those. So it just happened that we had, as terrible as our team was overall, we had a lot of guys that hit bonuses.
Yeah, and that's what happens when half your team plays and has career seasons, and the other team, half your team plays like AHL players.
I'd be even more upset if we were paying any sort of overage penalties because of our goalies' incentives.
Yeah, wouldn't that be a kick?
Like, that would be the real kicker on it. But so, you know, the O'Brien thing, like you said, it's probably just a clerical mistake. But I don't know, it's just the fact that it comes to this, and that we need that money this year, that's like, this really stings. And
yeah,
I hope whoever made that mistake knows what they did wrong. I mean, it's not like, I was almost going to say we should go back and check the Mason Raymond bio paperwork, but there's no more compliance buyouts.
Yeah, I don't think that anybody thought that it would be an issue. And I think that they left the window open so that way they'd have the two compliance buyout slots still, in case they, say, acquired a guy like Mike Ribeiro to then buy out.
Yeah, but I couldn't have seen them doing two.
Yeah, but I think they were just wanting the flexibility, not expecting their team to have so many players overperform to cause this situation. But stuff happens, and unfortunately, it bites the Flames this year.
So we'll take our lumps on this one.
Not much you can do.
Yeah, we'll take our lumps on this one, but it's just sort of an interesting clerical error that happened. But I think you're right, and I mean, we'll talk more about the roster in this show and some of our next shows as we get ready for the season. But I think that, and we say this every year, but I think this year more than ever, a move has to be made. We have to move a contract, I would say, you know, it's some contract over $1 million has to be moved out of here.
Yeah, and whether that's a guy like Bullig just to save a couple hundred thousand or something more substantial like trading Weidman, something does have to be done.
But the flip side of that is it also opens up probably at least one or two spots for a cheap young player to say, hey, I'm good enough.
For
and
sure.
I think you'll see at least one surprise player on this roster, a guy that maybe we didn't pencil into our initial lineups because he's cheap.
Garnett Hathaway, come on down.
Could be Hathaway. I got a couple other names on my list, but you know, I think we'll talk about later. But yeah, I think you might see a guy like Lyndon Vay at $700,000 who say, you know what, you're good enough and you're cheap. Until we figure this out, you're on the roster.
I agree.
We talked about our UFAs earlier for next year. Our RFAs are Sam Bennett, and that's going to be a big contract that we're going to have to deal with. Michael Ferland, Alex Chason, if we choose to qualify those guys, I don't think either guy gets more than $1 million. And Jyrki Jokapacka, if we don't lose him, I think he could be primed to be lost to Vegas in the draft. But if not, again, probably $1.5 million, $1.8 million, somewhere in there. So not a whole lot of RFAs that are going to demand a ton of cash next year.
No, and even Sam Bennett, unless he completely tears it up this year, I don't see it being more than a $3 to $4 million contract.
So you think pretty much what we lose in the Stajan, or Stajan's got 2 years, but I guess what we lose in like the Weidman contract, we can pay probably Bennett and still have some money left over.
Probably.
You could be right.
Like, unless Bennett puts up like a 50-plus point season or a 60-point season with like 30 goals, then I don't see him being much more than a 4-5, 3-4-5 in there.
And talking about Bennett having a good year, I mean, here's a guy who, over the summer, he put on 10 pounds of muscle. 10 pounds! Like, he's 200 pounds now, and I think that, if anything, just that added muscle definition could let him play the game that he wants to play.
Yeah. And hopefully he has a healthy season and doesn't get any weird random injuries with how the type of game he plays. And hopefully he's a little bit more assertive on a more consistent basis. Because I know last year he had some ups and downs, where long stretches where he was just okay, and then like that 4-goal game coming out of nowhere. So hopefully he has more consistency throughout the year. And If he's put on a line with Tkachuk and Brouwer, that'll be fun.
Well, let's talk about that then. Let's talk about the lineup, shall we?
Sure.
So, I mean, we're talking about this pre-training camp, so we haven't seen many of the veterans besides the guys that played World Cup. So we don't know how everyone's going to look. So, as Matt mentioned earlier, anything can change, but let's not get into the what-ifs, maybes. Let's talk about kind of penciling in a lineup today. Make sense?
Sure.
So, first line. Any doubt? Let's assume Gaudreau resigns. Fair?
Yeah, sure.
So Gaudreau, Monahan, no doubt, I think, left wing and centerman on the first line.
Yep.
We got to find them a right winger.
And this is where there's a couple of options, and I think it largely depends on who plays well in training camp. For me, the more likely situation is a guy like Hunter Shinkaruk. Because I don't think that you're going to need a veteran guy on that line. I don't see them putting Brouwer or Frolik, which intrinsically does make more sense because you want your better free agent signing to play with your better players. But I don't think for...
Brouwer's making second line money, though.
Yeah, but I don't think that you want to have all your talent clustered on one line like it has been done. I think you're going to want to spread that out so you have like three really dynamite effective lines. So I think if you put a younger player that is NHL ready, which I do believe Shinkaruk is, I think that would make some sense. Alternatively, and I think this might be an interesting thing, is putting Mark Jankowski on the first line. He did play in the NCAA in his first year as a right winger, so he does have experience playing on the right side. And with his size, that will help to make up for Gaudreau's lack of height. Again, it would depend largely on how each of those guys does in the preseason.
So Jankowski is 6'3". For those that don't know, he's listed as a centerman. He did play wing when he first entered college. I know what you're saying, Matt. I'm not sure that I mean, for a guy who comes from the NCAA, they often struggle, especially forwards, at the NHL level. So I'm not sure I'd want to give him first-line minutes right away, saying, you know, I could see him working his way to the first line, but I'm not sure that on opening day I want to give him that many minutes.
No, and, like, I know where you're coming from, and that's where some of the other guys like Chason or Preble, they might be tested out in that spot as well.
See, I don't think Preble makes the lineup, so I'm going to take his name out. I had Chason potentially there, I think. I mean, last year we saw, like, Ferlin play there. So I think that we're going to have a pair and then really just either a setup or a muscle guy. I could see Ferland on that line sort of to be the muscle, to go into the corners, to get the puck, and then send it to the front of the net and let Monahan and Gaudreau do their thing. But I don't think that Ferland stays there. I honestly think that I had on my list here Shinkarik up there.
Yeah, that's the first name on my list as well.
I think, you know, with the price that the Flames paid for him, not that it was a huge price, but Granlund was a full-time Flame at the time. You know, Shinkarik was an elite prospect in Vancouver, I'd say. I think Shinkarik is ready.
Yeah.
I don't think he stays on the top line all year, but I think it lets you really see what you've got there.
And plus, one of the things that the Flames lack on that line is a pure sniper. And that is what Shinkarik is a sniper-type player. So, and I think that, like, moving forward, if Shinkarik doesn't work out, when the Flames go to acquire the guy to put with those two players, that you're going to have more of a sniper-type forward with those two guys.
Yeah, I think Shinkarik gets the job, and I think it's his to lose. I mean, if he can, you know, if he can stay there, fantastic. If he can play with these guys and make it work, great. But I think if not, I honestly think that, you know, come deadline day, we're going to see that somewhere during the season, the Flames have acquired a player to play there. I think that's a long-term acquisition.
Yeah, whether it's during the season or for next offseason, either way, that will be, like, the next thing on the hit list.
I think they'll try Brouwer there, but I don't think he'll stay there. I think ultimately line two is Bennett in the center and Brouwer on the right side.
Yeah, and if Tkachuk makes the team, that would be a hell of a fun line. Like, man, would that get under everybody's skin, having
but
those
not,
three guys
we
together.
Find them a left winger.
True, and that's where you could cycle in a guy like Shinkarik or Ferland or a handful of players.
What about Higgins if we sign him?
That wouldn't be ideal, but sure. Yeah, you could.
I've been told that Coach Glenn Gulletson has told Matt Stajan that he should expect to see some minutes on left wing. Just because we don't have a lot of options, I could potentially see Stajan up there, though I don't think he's a second liner all season.
No, he would be a good fourth line left wing.
I don't think Boma is ready for second line minutes.
A line with Boma, Ferland, or Boma, Backlund, and Frolik might make some sense, but
I just don't know that Boma has showed us that he's earned second line minutes yet.
No.
I mean, just looking at the roster, Bolig's not going to play there.
No, for sure.
Chason's a right. You could maybe put him on the left, but we don't have enough right wingers, so you don't want to be converting guys. What about bringing up a guy like Poirier to play there?
He has to prove that he's actually ready for the NHL, and this season, if he doesn't step it up, you know, like, I think that you'll see him traded at some point for something else.
To me, I think you're going to see Bennett and Brouwer there and just a cycling group of left-wingers.
Yeah, unless Tkachuk makes the NHL and stays there.
The only other possibility, though I don't think you do it, and I'll explain why when I get to my third line, is putting Frolik there.
Possible, but
to me, I would make my third line Backlund, Frolik, Boma.
Yeah, and like that's why, like, I wouldn't want to see either Brouwer or Frolik with the top line, because in order to be successful, you need to have three quality lines, and if you're consolidating too much in the top six, then it leaves the third and fourth line to be crap, basically.
See, I think we could still build a decent third line, even if let's say we move Frolik to line one, Gaudreau, Monahan, Frolik, since he's a natural right winger. Line two of Bennett, Brouwer, and whoever. I still think you could do a third line of like a Boma, Backlund, Chiasson. It's not going to be a terrible third line.
No, it would be adequate, but it'd be mediocre.
But I'm just wondering if Frolik is going to be a better third liner or better filling that first line, you know, wing spot.
Yeah, and that's one of those things.
I'd rather see Frolik on line one than Brouwer, just because I think that Bennett needs Brouwer more than Backlund needs Frolik.
True. It largely depends on how the chemistry works between those players, because I know Frolik was tried up there a couple of times last year, and he didn't really look very good, so...
But to be fair, though, he wasn't the only guy who didn't look good. Like,
true.
You know, I think that we kind of have to discount in some ways what happened last season, just saying this is not a good team, and
yeah.
Give it another shot.
Yeah, oh, for sure, and that's why, like, what you said, like, I think we'll see a whole bunch of different guys getting cycled through in that first line spot.
But I think it's the full time is either going to come down to Shinkarak or Frolik.
Yeah.
I think Brouwer will be tried, but Bennett needs Brouwer to be veteran leadership. I think the third line is Backlund, Boma, and whoever, Frolik or Shinkarak, is not on line one.
Yeah.
And the fourth line then comes down to Stajan, Chiasson, and Bolig?
I guess.
I mean, I think Stajan is, unless... Stajan could be a third line left winger. I don't see a point in converting him to left on the fourth line. Like, if he's going to be on the fourth, he might as well just leave him at center.
Unless the only way that it would make sense to have him as the left winger on the fourth line is if you're putting and installing Jankowski as the fourth line center. And that way he can learn with Stajan. And, like, they can bounce off each other.
Yeah, it's true.
So, Jankowski is a very good defensive player. So, having another very good defensive player with him to tutor him on those kind of things might help.
Yeah, could be. Maybe he'll even tutor Jankowski on contract negotiations, because he's obviously doing it right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not sold on Jankowski making the team out of camp. I think it could happen, but to me, I don't put him... If the Flames are trying to make a postseason run, which I think they are, to me, I wouldn't... I mean, I think that he's definitely... Jankowski's probably the first guy.
To me, like, if Tkachuk makes the team, Jankowski, I don't think, makes it as well. But if Tkachuk gets sent back to the OHL, I think Jankowski's on the team.
Yeah, and I don't want them to rush Tkachuk. To me, there's no rush. Unless he looks spectacular, there's no rush to bring him up.
Exactly. So,
and I think we saw with Bennett that sometimes OHL seasoning's a good thing.
Yeah, so I think it just largely depends on Tkachuk, really. Like, if he's NHL ready, I think you just have Jankowski start the year as the first line center, tear up the A for half a season, and get called up. But
yeah,
if Tkachuk's down, then you need a spot, and I think that you're the best player to put there is Jankowski, so it just complicates things, but training camp's for. So
it's interesting, because we left the season, you and I, saying how the Flames need to address the right wing, and on paper they've done that. They now have enough right wingers.
Yeah, but still, I think that will be the number one thing that the Flames will still continue to address until they figure out, like, a permanent solution.
But to me, I mean, looking at these rosters on at least a forward, we'll talk defense in a second. If we're saying this is a team that's going to go deep in the playoffs, and we'll give our predictions on this season in a little bit, but if this is a team that's going to go deep in the playoffs, I don't know of any other team that's had a hole on both of the top two lines. Like, you know, we've got no right winger on line one and no left winger on line two. Like, to me, we're still missing some key pieces here.
Yeah. And that's unless Tkachuk plays up to snuff to play reliably as the second line left winger. But that will be figured out in training camp.
you know, like you and I are sitting here kind of taking a bunch of names who are a bunch of probably bottom six guys. Like we got, you know, Boma, Stajan, Chason, Bolig, Vey, and it's just kind of shuffle them around to where there's an opening. You know, sure. Like we could put these in six different formations. It's just a bunch of spare pieces. So I think that, yeah, we're still missing a couple key spots here.
Yeah, and realistically, this is the last year of the rebuild, in my opinion. I think that because of the amount of high-dollar contracts that are expiring and the question mark about Tkachuk being in the NHL and or not and all that kind of stuff, like, that'll be sorted out. Like, there's no doubt in my mind that he's not in the lineup this time next year. Jankowski's in the lineup this time next year. So...
Yeah, I think you're right. Once we free up the money, we can go and get exactly what we need after this. We know the positions we need now. We can go fill them.
Yeah, like if we need a number four defenseman, that's easy enough to target a quality guy.
Number one right winger?
Yeah. If we need a change of the goaltender for whatever reason, that can be done. Whatever, whatever. It can all be sorted out. It's just a matter of figuring out the exact details.
Well, you mentioned a top four defenseman, so let's go to that part of the lineup. Any doubt Gio Brody's our number one pairing again?
No. And until Gio leaves the team or whatever, I think, or declines significantly, I think that's the first pairing for the next, like, 3-4 years.
I saw some discussion that Gullison might want to break him up. I think he'd be stupid to do that.
Yeah, same here.
There's a proven pairing, which leaves our second pairing as Hamilton and whom? Any doubt that Hamilton's pairing too?
Yeah, he's definitely the number three defenseman. I personally think
he's going to have a great season under a new coach.
Yeah. For me, the number four right now is Jokipaka, just out of necessity. I don't think the Flames have a number four defenseman right now.
No, and I mean, if you look at what we gave up to get him, he replaced the number four defenseman. So, yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, and... which makes the third pairing Weidman and England, which is not ideal having two slow defensemen, but...
It's a lot of money for a third pairing defense.
Yeah, and that's why I'm hoping that there's a move before the start of the season that sees one of the two go, but if that's how it ends up being, that's how it ends up being.
It's $8 million tied up in our third pairing.
Yeah, yeah. And unfortunately, that's how it happens sometimes. And
I have a feeling that Gullison's going to give Weidman a shot just because he's a veteran guy at the second pairing with Hamilton. But I think Weidman's going to lose the job to Jokipaka just sort of by default.
I agree. And, yeah, ideally the Flames will find somebody to take Weidman. If not, yeah, like if the perfect case scenario is that Weidman, that hypothetical deal for Hayes works out, and then you go and sign Chris Russell or Jakob Nekloddle or Dennis Seidenberg or somebody to be the 4-5 guy and on a more reasonable contract and call it a day.
Yeah, but again, I mean, if we're looking at this, and I sort of agree with your earlier assessment that this is still a rebuild year, I think Jokipaka is suitable for this year.
Yeah.
You know, is Jokipaka your fourth defenseman if you're planning for a third or fourth round playoff run? No.
No, not at all.
Looking at this as still a rebuild year, not saying they couldn't make the playoffs, but if we admit this is still a year of the rebuild, Jokipaka fits the bill. And I think it's Jokipaka's chance to show what he's got or doesn't as well.
For sure.
It was the last year of his contract, so he's going to need a new deal. Guys always play well in the last year of their deal.
And realistically, the Flames have guys coming up like Shillington, like Anderson, like Hickey, that are going to be knocking at the door to take those 5-6 spots as well. So if...
Yeah. I think we got guys who are a year away. I don't think any of them are ready yet, besides maybe Wotherspoon, but not for top four. But I think we got guys who are about a year away.
Yeah. And realistically, Shillington could probably get recalled halfway through the season if he plays well defensively. So there's options if necessary down the road, but unfortunately, the Flames are just stuck in the halfway zone. Like, if, say, the Flames had an extra $6 million in contract space this offseason, I think David Backes would have been a Flame as well. But they didn't, so it is what it is.
And if you look at it, most of our bad money's on the blue line.
Yeah, and at the time, the Flames needed to spend money there because we absolutely had nobody on the prospect pool.
Like, Larry when you're Schmid only is $3.5 million, though. I think we're both admitting he's probably IR. I think he's done as an NHLer.
Yeah. Even if he's better, I think he's done as an NHLer.
Well, I just don't think with what we're seeing from concussion stuff now, I don't think anyone takes a shot at him.
No. Neither do I.
So I think you find yourself go find yourself a nice cushy office job somewhere, laddie. But yeah, I just think with all the concussion stuff that's coming out, no one's going to touch it.
No.
So I mean, laddie's gone. So would you carry a seventh defenseman?
Not. It depends on how much cap space, but probably not.
And if there were a seventh defenseman, let's say the first call up, who would that be for you?
Wotherspoon, just out of he's the oldest.
I think that, honestly, I could see them carrying Wotherspoon.
Yeah, that would be, like, if the Flames carry him, that's who it would be.
I kind of think that Wotherspoon's at this place in his career, sort of like where Granlund was, where, you know, you have to make it now, and I think they're going to give him every chance they can to get him on the ice, to give him a chance to earn another deal.
Yeah.
I don't think it's really fair to say, oh, you're a, you know, an older guy for the AHL, but we're sticking you back in the AL years, so you can't earn it.
Yeah.
And I could honestly easily see Wotherspoon surpassing Weidman. I'd hate to have a $5.5 million seventh defenseman, but I think if Wotherspoon knows this is his last year to make an impression, I could see him fitting in well with England.
And that is a realistic possibility as well. So it just depends on Weidman, really. Like, if he plays like he did 2 years ago in training camp and shows that he has his stuff again, then fine, you just play him, like, who cares? And if not, then you gotta make alterations to your lineup.
I think that without a huge move, like moving out a Weidman contract, I think the team can probably budget about $1 million still for a defenseman.
Yeah, I can agree with that.
And then I don't think there's probably any dispute in goal who our goalies are. Elliot is our starter and Johnson's our backup.
I think to debate that, no.
You are?
No.
I think Gillies could get a look, but I don't think that Gillies... I mean, to me, I don't see any reason to bring Gillies up to sit on the bench.
No, neither do I.
And I don't think that Gillies is going to beat Brian Elliott for a job.
No, and even if he did, you don't want to rush him anyway. So, like, put it this way, if Gillies, say he plays two games and he has two shutouts, that, like, 50 save shutouts, he's still going to be in the minors to start the season. So.
I think the whole fact that he was hurt all last year pretty much says that he's playing in the AHL all year, like it or not.
Yeah, unless they run into injuries down the road, in which case then you just bring him up and play him.
Sign Kerry Ramo and bring him back. And
it depends on how severe the injury, but like say one of the two goalies is out for the season in November, I could see that.
Would you call Ramo or Jerry McDonald first?
Ramo.
He's still got his Flames pads hanging around somewhere. Yeah, I don't know. Like, I think, and any of these positions are obviously subject to injury, but unless we have injury, to me, goalie is the only place where we have no weaknesses. Like, if you look at our goaltending this year, it looks like an NHL goaltending tandem.
Well, not only an NHL goalie tandem, but they were two of the top guys for save percentage last season, so a well above average goalie tandem.
Because if you look at our usual tandem tier, like when Kipper was here, we had, you know, terrible backups, guys no one's heard of, guys that were just terrible because we knew we could rely on one goalie. And I think, you know, even the last couple of years since Kipper left, it's kind of let's bring in some decent goalies. But I think this is the first year we've really had we have a good starter and, a very good backup to go with them. Like, think about some of the guys they brought in to back up Kipper, like McElhaney, Carlson, just these guys that
it's Leland,
like,
okay, Irving.
Exactly. Like, we hope they don't have to go in the net because they're not going to get the job done.
Danny Taylor.
But like, I think just, that with me, Johnson, I think Johnson could play 20 games this year, and I'd be confident with him.
I think Johnson could play 30 or 40 games if necessary and be perfectly fine. So, like, you got to remember, Elliott's never played more than, I think, 50 games at the NHL level.
Yeah, he's also been in sort of a 1A, 1B scenario for the last couple
of
years.
So, I don't see him magically playing 60-plus.
I don't know. I don't think it doesn't mean he's not capable of it. I just don't think he's been in an environment where that was something he would do, because he's sort of been in a 1A, 1B there.
Yeah. But if the Flames have a good backup, why not use them? Keep both guys fresh, and that way you're going to be having quality goaltending throughout the season instead of fatigue issues down the road.
I can see Johnson signing here longer term as a backup. I mean, he's a Calgary boy. It sounds like he likes it here. I could kind of see him sign a 2-3-year backup deal, and whether it's Elliott or somebody else he's backing up, him being here for a little bit. I don't think he's going to get a 6 or 8 year deal, but I could see him sign another 2-3 years after this if he plays well.
Yeah, depends on how everybody plays.
Fairly young goalie tandem, too. Brian Elliott's only 31, and Chad Johnson's 30. So, I mean, you know, generally you're not seeing guys in their 20s unless they're a real star goaltender getting a starter job. So both those guys, I'd say, based on the goalie curve, probably about at their peak.
Yep.
Troy Brower, also 31. Not an old team this year. Stajan's 32. England's 34. Geo's 32. And Smead is 30. And Weidman's 33. So a lot of younger players coming in.
Yep.
So looking at that roster, I mean, I think it's good. I think it's definitely going to get us better result than last year. Just the net upgrades alone. But still some big question marks for me. And we'll see how they break down as the off season goes on and the preseason starts.
Well, if you look at it, last year it was literally a tale of two teams. One, you had the top half of the lineup, they all had career years and were basically moving towards being a contender, and then the other half was like AHL substandard quality.
Well, if
or
you look
worse.
At the names, it was an AHL team in the bottom six.
Yeah. So the fact that they've swapped out a bunch of those players that were bad and have upgraded them to good quality players, just that should make the Flames a playoff team or very close to it. So hopefully things change and we don't have a repeat of last year.
Yeah, I guess it's now when I just look at the roster compared to last year and you're like, you know what? It's now, it's a time like now when you kind of miss Hudler. You know, like having that defined first line.
Yeah. But at least it gives the Flames options to try out a whole host of different players and see what works. And if, you know, who knows who might work there. You know, a guy like Shane Carrick might just slot in, fit like a glove, and all of them tear off the cover of the puck. So we'll
see.
I'd
like that just because it would be a great slap in the face to Vancouver.
Oh, yeah. Same here. Like, if he put up a 30-goal season, that would just be awesome.
and especially if Granlund struggles. If Granlund gets, like, 8 points and Shinkara gets, you know, like a 30-goal, 50-point season or something.
Yeah. That'd be awesome.
But, yeah, it'll definitely be an interesting year, and I think we've got some, like you said, some guys that have to rise to the occasion. We did talk a little bit, though, about some of the prospective positions the Flames need to sign. I think the biggest one, and the one I see them throwing money at, just because we're sort of short there, is on the blue line. I think we can fill the forward spots through call-ups and through farm guys, but I think we're going to have to make a signing to fill a seventh defenseman spot. And some of the rumors that have been out there is Jakub Nekladl coming back. I'd be fine with that. I think the only reason that hasn't happened is they're waiting for the Gaudreau thing. I think once Johnny signs, I don't know about you, I think once Johnny signs, we see like two or three signings like within days or hours of it.
I agree.
What kind of money we've got. I wouldn't also be surprised if we see a big move and then like 20 minutes later, a Gaudreau signing. You know, like move out a big contract and then sign Gaudreau. But we talked about Nekladl. Another rumor that's out there is a former Flames defenseman who we moved to the deadline who's still looking for a job. And it's been said the Flames are talking to Chris Russell. What would you think about bringing Russell back?
I'd have absolutely no problem with that whatsoever.
a lot of people online are, you know, really, they are really against this. But to me, I mean, even if we bring Russell back, what I think a reasonable contract for him would be $2 million, $2.5 million max.
Yeah, in that neighborhood.
If we could move out a Weidman deal and bring Russell in for $2.25 million, I'd be happy to have him back. I don't want to pay him $4 million. I don't want to even pay him upwards of $3 million, but I'd be happy to bring him back either as a give him his job back with Hamilton or put him with England. Either way, I think it gives us some flexibility, but he's a good NHL defenseman.
Yeah.
And you and I heard from Glenn Gullitson over the summer that diving's not going to be something we do here. Like, diving, he said, is what we do when we've lost all other options.
Diving to stop the puck.
Yeah, we've lost.
Clarifying that for listeners.
The puck. We have no other way to get it back, so we dive for it. So I think that you'd see Russell play a different game, but I think he's adaptable, that he could adapt to a different style.
Yeah.
Another player the Flames have been talking to, rumored, is 35-year-old defenseman. Most people are going to know him from either his time in Carolina or Boston, is Dennis Seidenberg. He's a left-shooting defenseman, 35 years old, from Germany. No PTO has been made to him yet, which I think would be the first step for an older guy like Seidenberg. I don't see a deal for Seidenberg being any more than 1 year just because of his age, but what would you think about bringing him in as, say, a seventh defenseman?
Couldn't hurt. Period. Has been a quality defenseman for his entire NHL career. I'd have no problem with that.
If you had to pick one of him or Nikladal, who would you pick?
I'd take Seidenberg.
If you had to pick one of Seidenberg or Russell, who would you pick?
Russell.
I honestly think the Flames, if the biggest part's going to be find a buyer for Weidman with that contract. But if they can, I could see him bringing Seidenberg and Russell in.
Yeah.
Move one, get two. Heck, you'd have the money to get all three if you wanted them, but we just don't have the spot for them.
That's possible.
But, yeah, I think Russell would be number one on my list. I think Seidenberg on a 1 year just buys us time. He's a good enough defenseman that he could be number seven. I'd feel comfortable with him stepping in for 10 games at a time, 12 games at a time if somebody gets hurt. But I think that next year it's pretty much seen as, okay, you're here for a year to help us out. And then sort of like Nick Backstrom, you know, there's this sort of understanding that you're gone after this.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, Seidenberg would probably retire. I mean, he's at that age, and I think he'd buy us time to see what we've got in Shillington and Rasmus Anderson and, you know, Kenny Morrison and guys like that.
I agree entirely.
I think he'd be a great, well, not a great, I think given the circumstance, he'd be a good number seven. But I think for Seidenberg to do that, it's got to be I'd like to say sub million, but I think for him it's $1.5 million or less.
Yeah.
Just based on what he's made and where he's at.
And I don't think the Flames make a move to fill the number seven spot until they see what they've got in Wotherspoon. Like, if Wotherspoon actually comes to camp and plays good, like, he didn't play very good last year in the training camp, and I think that disappointed the Flames management quite a bit. But if he comes in and plays a quality number seven style game, then I don't think that you see them go out and sign anybody.
Well, I think the nice thing, too, there is fresh coaching.
Yeah.
You know, no preconceived notions over who's good and who's bad and that sort of thing.
Mm.
But, yeah, I agree with you. I think it's right now that number seven, or let's just say one of the seven, is Weidman's spot to lose. Or not Weidman, sorry. I think it's Wotherspoon's spot to lose. I think Wotherspoon loses it. You're right. They make a move. If he plays well, and he's at least plays well enough to be a number seven, he makes the team. Do you think that Grossman has any chance? I mean, if we've got guys like, I mean, let's say for the same price, you get Grossman and Nikladal. Do you take Grossman?
I'd probably take Nikladal due to his offensive talents.
And do you think Seidenberg will get offered a PTO?
Whether it's with us or somebody else, probably.
Yeah, I think that'll happen in the next couple of days here. I'm surprised a guy like that is still available. I mean, somebody's going to pick him up for depth.
Yeah. There's 30 teams. They need a defenseman. I think because he's playing in the World Cup, that's the reason why he hasn't been given a PTO yet.
Could be. Yeah, wait and see how he does. Wait until he gets home. And speaking of the World Cup, we had some Flames that actually managed to go. It seemed like everyone was dropping out of the World Cup this year. Monahan dropped out due to back injury. But it seemed like everyone was like, oh, I spilled some milk. I'm not going to the World Cup. Like, it's almost like All-Star games in some years where nobody wants to go. And I don't know about you, but I think that really sort of dampens things for the league. I think the league has put the World Cup in, my belief, to soften the blow of we're not going to South Korea for the Olympics.
Yeah.
And I think the fact that guys don't even want to play in the World Cup is sort of showing that there's not as much desire to play this kind of hockey if it's not Olympic hockey.
True. And, like, if you look at it, like, there's some athletes, like, say Ovechkin. Both of his parents played in the Olympics. And I think his mother won a medal for something or other. So, like, there's a desire because of it being the Olympics to actually go to the Olympics. And whereas this manufactured international-ish tournament with a couple of random teams that are just make-believe kind of makes it like a lame, cheap gimmick. Like, I'm not finding much desire myself to watch the games. Like, it's like, oh, Team Russia beat Team North America. Okay. Sure. You know, like...
To me, I think the whole, Team Europe and Team North America thing is what's really turned me off from this. If it was an actual Olympic-style tournament, it's one thing, but I feel like, yeah, they've kind of manufactured reasons for these guys to be in there. And I don't see why the North American guys, if they're good enough, couldn't just make Canada and the U.S. rosters.
Yeah, like, Gaudreau, he'd be on Team USA for sure. So, like, why is, you know, and, like, Team USA is playing kind of badly this tournament, where a guy like Gaudreau would probably be on their first line. Like, why, you know, why is he not on that team? Like, it just, it's poorly done.
I forget who it was, but some Russian player, I think a few years ago, I want to say it was Ovechkin, but said that growing up as a hockey player in Russia, you don't dream of winning the Stanley Cup. When you're a kid playing in the driveway, you dream of winning an Olympic gold medal. It's North American kids who dream of the Stanley Cup. So for a lot of these foreign guys, especially Russians, the Olympics means more to them. And I think that, you know, this kind of tournament, it's at a point in the season where guys, I mean, it's better now than when they do, you know, hockey at the end of the year over the playoffs where nobody wants to go because everyone's beat up. But I don't know. I think the NHL is going to have to find a way to sort of mandate guys to go, or this thing's going to quickly fall apart in coming years.
Yeah. And realistically, I think that the NHL should continue to go to the Olympics regardless, because, like, I think Ovechkin himself has said that he's going regardless, if, you know, and fine me, whatever, I'm gone. So
yeah, I'd say we can have a larger Olympic discussion during the season. To me, I don't think that we should shut down the whole league for a South Korean Olympics where it's the wrong time zones. It's not going to help hockey. But I think that just like sort of the World Cup, or not the World Cup, the World Juniors, maybe they can ask teams permission. You know, hey, can we have Ovechkin for 2 weeks?
Yeah.
But I don't know that it's worth shutting the whole league down for the South Korean Olympics. I understand where the league's coming from. You know, if it's in Canada, like if Calgary gets his 2026 bid, I expect the NHL players to be there. But, you know, I can understand why they don't want to send them to South Korea. It doesn't do anything for the game. And I can understand why some of these players, I mean, even a guy like Monahan, we don't know how badly his back was hurt, or if this is sort of the Flames saying, hey, you know, we just put a lot of money into you. We really don't want you to get hurt. Maybe you shouldn't go play there for your back. Like, I think they have to find something different. And if you look at the All-Star game, every year the skills comp is so huge. Maybe we need to do like a world skills comp or something. Or 3-on-3 style. But I don't know. Maybe this becomes part of the All-Star weekend where the teams play against each other instead of the four conferences like the world teams play. But I don't know a lot of people have watched the World Cup. And with the amount of good players that dropped out, I can't see this being sustainable.
No.
I don't know how often they're planning to do it, but I can't see it, you know, going forward. And I can't see the league mandating guys to go either. But, I mean, Monahan sat out. Gaudreau went. Backlund went. Frolik went. Nioki Paka went for the Flames. And, you know, my question going into this was, will this help the players be in better shape? We always see players, not a guy like Gaudreau, but we've always seen guys who come into camp not necessarily out of shape, but just rusty. And that's one good thing about this. It could, you know, help them knock some rust off. But at the same time, the premier players who'd be going to this probably aren't the ones that are going to be rusty.
Yeah.
You know, it's not Rasmus Anderson going, who's, you know, known to have some conditioning issues at the beginning of a season. But I think the guys like Gaudreau who are going, Backlund, Frolik, these are guys that are premier players, and they know how to be ready, and they're expected to be ready. So I don't see a lot of the benefit to anybody in this.
Yeah. Well,
I don't think the league's making as much as they wanted to. I think TV revenues aren't as high as they wanted. I've seen Pepsi cans at the grocery store with Team Canada logos. They probably sold a ton of advertising, but I just don't think it... I don't know your thoughts, but I just don't think it's worked as well as the league thought.
Yeah. Well, it's kind of a rushed, ham-handed tournament. Like, I don't see anybody like, oh, the World Cup's on. You know, it's like, okay, sure. I think it's hockey, but...
Well, that's it. I think part of it, too, like they always have the world championships right after the season, and nobody watches them because the playoffs are on. And I think this is sort of too close to the hockey season where hockey fans, like I'm kind of going, you know what? I got 82 games coming up plus preseason. Do I really need more hockey? And maybe if they did in the middle of July or something where people are starving for hockey, they might get more people watching or people playing. But I just think for the guys, they're like, you know what, I got a long season coming up. I don't need more hockey. I don't need more chance to get hurt. I just think it was, like you said, maybe rushed, maybe poorly conceived, but I just think that didn't work out well. But something that did work well was the Penticton tournament. This got to be what, like the sixth or seventh Penticton tournament? Sixth one. And as usual, for those that don't know, this is all the young players, all the Flames prospects that go and play against other teams' prospects. And this is a four-team tournament. It was Calgary, Winnipeg, Edmonton, Vancouver. I think we've seen other teams in the past. We've had, what, Florida in the past or something?
San Jose.
So they sort of change up every year, but it's always Calgary, Edmonton, Vancouver. And overall, the Flames did pretty well. They played three games. On September 16th, they beat the Jets 4-1. They beat the they lost to the Oilers 4-3 in overtime, and then beat the Canucks 4-3. So overall, Matt, you watched a lot more Penticton tournament. What'd you think of the overall body of work from these prospects?
I thought the Flames was the best team in the tournament. They did lose to Edmonton, but they dominated the game. It was more sloppy goaltending that allowed a couple of iffy goals that ended up causing the loss. On the whole, I thought the team played well. Some players better than others.
That's true of any team.
Yeah. Like, in the first couple of games, Tkachuk and Jankowski were getting under everybody's skin and generating a lot of offensive chances. And if the third player wasn't Austin Carroll, I think they probably would have had 5 or 6 points each. But it is what it is. From this past draft, Dylan Dubé, he looked okay. He had a couple of good scoring chances, but you could tell he was 18.
He had 1 point in the tournament, 1 assist, and he was +2.
Yeah, Parsons was good in his game action in both games, save for the one goal where he kind of kicked it to the Oiler player in front of the net, and thanks for the tap-in. Matthew Phillips, he was okay at times. He did score a goal, but he's very raw. I don't see him making the NHL before he's 23. If he does make the NHL, he needs to bulk up a bit and just get more used to playing at higher levels.
For where he was drafted, and I mean, that was sort of how he was projected. He was projected as being a raw talent, so that's really nothing surprising to hear.
Yeah, like, you can tell there's a lot of skill there, but it's just very raw. Stepan Falkovsky, he only played the one game, and it was a very up and down performance. For the first period or so, he wasn't very good. But you can see that he knows how to jump into the play and think the game well, and he can skate quickly, which is surprising for a 6'7" player. He's very raw, but there's NHL potential in there. It's just we won't know for probably another 2-3 years whether he will become an NHL player or not. And the leading point getter for the Calgary Flames in the tournament was Etu Tuola, the 6th-round pick who was the standout in the July development camp, and he was once again very excellent. He set up 3 goals and scored 1 himself. He was a physical presence all through the game, and I don't understand how he fell to the 6th round because he played like a 2nd-round pick or a 1st-round pick. And has since we drafted him. So hopefully he continues.
Good surprise for the Flames.
Yeah, and hopefully he continues to have that kind of a performance in Everett this season in the WHL and can push himself forward. For the other players that were there, I think that for drafted players, Shillington and Anderson both stood out as playing well. They didn't get a point between them, but they were just solid.
Shillington had a ton of shots, though. I mean, the official stats are showing that he had 12 shots and 1 assist is the official.
Well, that was they credit it to Shillington, but it was actually Kanzig. So,
yeah, but if those are what the official stats are showing,
yeah, but.
But even 12 shots from a defenseman, if you're looking, the only guy that got more shots than him on the whole team is Andrew Mangiapane. So, you know, that's pretty good, and I think that's showing that he's, and we knew that he has some offensive upside, but he's got to work on his defensive side still.
Yeah, and Ryan Lomberg played well, had 3 goals in the 3 games, and was easily getting under the other team's skin, and I think he'll be a quality AHL player next season for the Flames, and hopefully he can have another good season and might turn himself into the next Garnett Hathaway, who actually earns an NHL contract after signing an AHL deal and emerges in the NHL down the road.
Yeah, I don't know. Looking at the center depth we've got, I can't see Lomberg rising enough on the depth chart to get an NHL
deal. He can also play on the wing, too. He's not just exclusively a center. So.
But even then, I mean, I think we've got enough forward depth that I can't see him making it. But we'll see.
No, but again, if he shows well enough, you got to keep giving him more opportunities and see where he plateaus, because sometimes players do come out of nowhere.
Yeah, and I mean, we saw that with Josh Juris, and he had a good year. I mean, we'll see what happens with him this year. Hathaway had a good part year last year. We'll see what happens with him this year.
And for the walk-ons, there was 3 players that looked like they did enough to earn at least an AHL contract. Roman Dukov, a defenseman, he has earned an AHL contract, and it'll be interesting to see him over the course of the season. He looked very reliable as a defenseman.
So as Matt mentioned, Dukov has been signed strictly to a Stockton Heat deal. It has nothing to do with the Calgary Flames or any of their contracts. Strictly an AHL Heat deal.
And the other two are 2 forwards, Denis Kravchenko and Mikkel Agard. I think Agard, if the Flames are going to sign any of the forwards to a contract, it'll be him. Kravchenko, he's a little short, but he was a little feisty and did some things. I don't think that they'll offer him a contract, but an AHL deal like Dukov's would make sense if they do go that route.
Are Kravchenko and Agard both coming to main camp?
I don't know. I think so, though. I think all of them are.
Because that'll be the big test there.
Yeah. And I think
a guy like Agard can look good playing against arguably some weak prospect teams, but when you throw them on the ice with, you know, pros and AHL guys, it'll be interesting to see how they look.
Yeah, and I think Braden Burke will be coming as well to the main camp. He didn't look bad in his first and only game, but he wasn't great either, so
Braden Burke stood out at the camp, though, the prospect camp.
Yeah, so we'll see. I think that the Flames will probably end up signing 2 or 3 guys out of it, to at least to AHL contracts.
And we have to remember, too, these guys are young guys. A lot of them, you know, this is their first time they've been on the ice since the summer. Signs, especially for young guys who don't have that system down like a pro would, it can take a little bit to get going. So just because they're not looking good or not doing what we were expecting in Penticton doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to have a bad year.
Oh, no. Like this
and
is
a guy
just...
like Lomberg could look good because he's sort of a more senior guy among them.
Yeah, exactly.
And have a marginal year.
Yeah, and that it's just one of those things that if you're doing good, okay, let's go on to the season. Are you doing good in October? Are you doing good in November? Just keep going, checking on them as they go. And if they keep doing good, then you increase them in the organization of, hey, maybe we can rely on them to do more and see how it goes.
So a couple of forwards you didn't mention who fans are going to want to know about was number 19, Matthew Tkachuk, and number 77, Mark Jankowski.
Well, I did briefly at the beginning. They were good. They seem to have a good chemistry with one another. Tkachuk, in the third game, he was looking a little tired at times. But Tkachuk, if you've watched Anaheim at all in the last 10 years and watched Corey Perry play, that's who he is entirely. He is a total dirtbag, guy that you hate to play against, guy that you will absolutely loathe if you're not a Calgary Flames fan. So I'm glad he's on our team. I know.
Yeah, those are the kind of guys we want here.
Yeah, I'm sure that Brian Burke just had a huge smile when watching the game the entire time. Because, yeah, he was quite a pain. I think he drew like 4 penalties in a row in one of the games. And, yeah, he just has to walk that line where he's not taking too many undisciplined penalties. But you need to have players like Brad Marchand just to... Andrew Shaw, just like good teams, they always have that one guy that just really pisses off the other team. And, you know, Anaheim with Perry. And moving forward, that's the type of players that you're going to need if you're going to win a cup. You just need that. So hopefully, whether he's in the NHL this season or the next year, that he can continue to bring that feisty edge to him.
Both of those guys were really the standouts of the rookie development camp. I mean, you could tell, even if you didn't know who they were, just by looking at those two, you could probably pick out that they were Janko and Tkachuk. So it's good to see that, you know, they played well. You know, you're kind of mentioning that Carroll being on their line caused some interesting plays, but I think we're going to see the same thing on the main roster this year with a fill-in winger there. So, you know, kind of, I guess, synonymous of what we'll probably see this year. But, yeah, it's good that they're playing well, and it'll be curious to see how their development goes. I, in some ways, agree with you that I think one of them will make the Flames roster at some point this year. I think everyone always wants to see the new draft pick. Everybody always wants to see, oh, we drafted Tkachuk. I want him on the roster. I'm not convinced that's the right move this year. I'm not saying they shouldn't, but I just don't want them to rush him in there. There's no reason to. But I think for me, it's more likely that we'll see Jankowski wearing a flaming C than Tkachuk this year.
And I can agree with that. It largely just depends on how Tkachuk plays. Like, if he comes to the main camp and plays like Monahan did in his rookie year, why not see how he goes? And worst case scenario is after the 9 games, you send them back down to juniors and call it a day. But I think one of the two will play in the NHL this season for most of the year. It's just which. That's all. Jankowski is very reliable defensively. I didn't mention that earlier. He was probably the best defensive player on any of the teams for forwards. And he looked like an NHL player. He's still a little rough around the edges, don't get me wrong. Like, he's not going to step in and be a 40-point player. It's just... he's ready for more. Whether he's going to be the first liner in Stockton or in the NHL, either on the wing or
at
center.
And he could straddle both.
Yeah. So it just depends on how they want to play him. Like, the coach could do what they did with Bennett last year and have him just ease in on the wing, because he can play either wing. So there's options.
I can see them starting Jankowski in the AHL, building some confidence there, and then about Christmas promoting him.
That works too. So
send him to the A, let him chew up a ton of minutes, get some points, and then say, "All right, kid, you've shown you can still do it," because he played AHL at the end of the year, and then all right, up you come.
Yep. There's no
and
wrong.
And also gives him some time to try and make a roster move too.
Yeah, there's no wrong move with this. So either way, they're going to be getting quality ice time in both cases, whether it's in the NHL or it's in the AHL or it's in the OHL. So it's just a matter of waiting to see how they respond to the next set of games and if they can play at that level where they can just lock into the NHL and play, or if they need more time. Just have to wait and see.
So, Matt, we've talked about, I think, all of the news that we have to look at over the summer. We're coming into the first games of the hockey season officially, I guess. Officially, unofficially, we have the exhibition schedule starting. It's the 20th of December now, and the 26th we have our first games. What are you looking forward to about this exhibition season? We'll talk about the longer 82-game season as we get closer, but what are you looking forward to watching sort of as storylines during this preseason?
Well, obviously, this team has pairings in each of the top three lines.
We talked about those being Gaudreau-Monahan, probably Bennett, Brower, Backlund, Frolik.
Yeah. Who are going to be the third wheel on each of those pairings? And that's the thing I'm most excited about, because the Flames do have about 15 options that can fit in each of those spots. It's just which one is going to work out best. So whether it's guys like Tkachuk or Shinkarik or Jankowski, Ferland, who knows? So at least there is options, and that is the most exciting thing for me, is to see how it'll shake out.
To me, I think the biggest thing I'm looking forward to is seeing what a Glenn Gullitson Calgary Flames team plays like. I think that we're going to see a different... I don't think it's going to be drastically different, but I think we'll see some differences right away in the preseason. I think the diving thing is going to be one of them. I think that Gullitson is going to and has already started to put his mark on this team just based on talking to players and what he wants to do there. So I'll be curious to see what they look like. But I agree with you. I think it'll be not so much seeing who necessarily makes those third spots in the lineups, but what young players rise to the occasion. Does Shinkarik make the first line, or does he make the third line? Are the Flames forced to kind of make uncomfortable moves, like putting Brower on the first line because it's all we've got? And I really think that that's going to set the momentum for the rest of the season. If we've got a lot of guys like 2 years ago, a lot of young guys who are doing whatever it takes to win, this could be a great team.
Yeah. And I, by the way, when you're talking about Gullitson and his his coaching system, I think the Flames this year will be a lot more defensively responsible. Not like trap style defensive like Dave Tippett, but just dialing it down a bit from the wheeling running gun style that we played last year.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. And I think that we're going to see them kind of working more as a team, but also I think every line having more of an identity. I think that last year we kind of saw the lines get shuffled a lot, and that was one of Hartley's MOs, was shuffling up his lines more than a lot of coaches would. And I think we're going to see each line really have an identity and know kind of what its role is on the team more than maybe we've seen in the last couple of years under Bob Hartley.
Yep.
But I think that the only real storylines that we have left, I mean, we filled most of the big holes. It's just going to be what young players slot in and where.
Yeah, and that's just more... We just don't have that information because we just have to wait and see how they play in the games.
One of the names I have written down here is Poirier. I don't think he's going to make the NHL team, but I'm really curious to see if he can bounce back in preseason. He struggled last year in the AHL. I think Morrison. And
Klimchuk.
Even a guy like Rasmus Anderson, I think, all need to have really good camps to set up a good year.
Yeah, and I think that, if, say, Poirier and Klimchuk struggle this year, I would not be shocked if they were included in trades, either at the deadline or like, say, in a hypothetical Weidman trade. So, we'll see.
And maybe, you know, maybe the fact that we do have guys like Janko, guys like Tkachuk, who are pushing for that spot might push the rest of the forwards. Because, I mean, Poirier and Klimchuk were sort of seen as the next big guys for a while, and maybe they started coasting on that notion. But, you know, maybe that pushes everybody to be better. We saw that 2 years ago when everybody got better because everyone was pushing for a roster spot.
Yeah, and competition brings out the best. So, and whether that's a guy like Ferland, who knows? He might step into that first line role.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know either, but
I think
stranger things could happen.
Ferland.
Oh, same here, but stranger things can happen. So
they could sign you for that first line role. They still have salary left. You'll play.
They
want to
win, though, so, you know, no.
as we get close to the season, Matt and I, after we've sort of done some analysis of the preseason, we'll give some thoughts on the 82-game season and where we think this team might end up and some thoughts and expectations for that.
Yeah, well, it's kind of hard to do that now when we don't even know who's roughly going to be on each line, so.
We've got three-quarters of each line.
Yeah, so.
Or two-thirds of each line, I guess. So, Matt, with that then, it's time to go back to what we always do, and that's our prediction game at the end of the show. We've got three games to predict for the first time in a while, actually four games. On the 26th, we have a split squad game with Edmonton. Half of our players will be in Calgary, half of them will be in Edmonton, and same thing with the Oilers. That's both a home and away game. On Tuesday, we have an away game against the Winnipeg Jets, and then on the 30th, the last day of September. Wow, we're getting close to hockey season. We're back at home against the Vancouver Canucks. So the same teams that we took on in the Penticton tournament are the first three teams we play officially on the exhibition schedule. Thoughts for these four games?
4-0.
4-0, you think so?
Yep, why not? Let's start off with a bang. We want to be the preseason champions. You know? That's something that Vancouver's held on to for a number of years. It's time to steal their thunder.
Wasn't there one preseason a while ago where we were defeated in all the games?
Yeah. Well, I think just like after last year getting off to such a horrid start that, you know, the Flames need to be ready for the start of the season. So hopefully getting off on a good start to the training camp will push that ahead.
I think we're going to go 2-2. I think we will win the home Edmonton game simply because we're going to ice a better roster at home. And if you look at the prospect roster Edmonton had in the Penticton tournament, it was terrible. So I think that they'll probably send their better guys, keep their better guys in Edmonton, send us the lesser guys. That's generally how it works. I think we'll lose to Winnipeg, and I think we'll beat Vancouver. So I think we'll win the Edmonton split squad in Calgary, lose the Edmonton split squad in Edmonton. I think we'll lose to Vancouver or lose to Winnipeg and win to Vancouver. So, Matt, you enjoy the first couple of preseason games, and we will talk to you shortly.
Have a good week. Thanks for listening, everybody. Nice to be back on the podcast, and have a good one.
The only sad thing is it means winter's coming.
Well, it is what it is.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.